worship today, we will be having a serious conversation about contracts and covenants. And I want to make sure that none of you in this room enter into this conversation without realizing the importance of this sacred conversation and what it means as people of faith. I mean, we live as Americans in a world of contracts. And these are important documents to make sure that we have set appropriate boundaries, expectations, and legal responsibilities. I mean, this is such a part of our culture, and it is important that we make sure to protect ourselves, whether that be good or bad, in the culture of which we are a part. The contract, however, is being signed by those who have not grown up in the same type of legalistic culture. And our board has done a really good job of recognizing this. And thus, they have worked hard with me to make sure that we help all of those voices that are involved understand the legal and contract aspects of this new relationship. Yet when it starts to get complicated, as any relationship will, and the first thing goes wrong, and the first people get mad, we must start to prepare ourselves for our response to be one of our culture of faith and not one of society's culture. Because we are part of both. And yet, we as Christians have chosen the greater part to seek ways to find God's kingdom here on this earth, as the Bible calls us to do. If we even think in much more extreme biblical terms, we are not called to crucify, which is often the way it feels in our current society's legal system. We are called instead, in today's scripture, to serve. We're not called to see ourselves as the greatest in any situation. We are called to humble ourselves and find what is great and good and God in all. We as Christians are not people of contracts. Christians, people who follow Christ, are people of covenant. Covenants matter. They are not empty promises or legalistic contracts. They are faith-filled, intentional ways of engaging in a community that puts God at the forefront of our lives and our focus. The Kentucky Islanders Church should never be seen as the other church. Instead, they are going to be a part of our denomination and already are in multiple covenants with us. They are another worshiping congregation, but today, when we make covenants with one another, we are welcoming them on a sacred level of what it means to be a church family. They are choosing and asking us to be at the tables where we all sit. And if we are to welcome them as Christ welcomes, we must prepare ourselves to serve in this new, complicated, and grace-filled relationship. Because we know that this relationship will not be easy. It will have crosses to bear. There will be, just as there were with the disciples and Jesus, denials, even betrayals at times. There will be discussions that miss the point, and there will be times when we all forget that we are called to serve, that we are called to be different in this world and rise to the challenges of what it means to follow Jesus. And just like us, the new worshiping community will be challenged to learn what it means to live in this multi-level relationship. They too we'll be trying to figure out what it means to be a part of this example of the body of Christ and to recognize that there will be moments when its brokenness is felt and its true healing comes through the invitations of Jesus. As your pastor, I want to make sure that we are prepared for the difficult moments. The fact that there are going to be some things that are different, some things that are new. There may be moments when we hear the echoes of Peter's denial and start to wonder where the betrayals might begin. How will we, as individuals and as a community, behave when these things start to happen? Because things will happen. And yet Jesus today reminds us where to look. We must look towards our children, as instructed in today's scripture. We must remind ourselves that all of us, too, are children of God. I mean, think about them. If our children from both worshiping congregations were brought together to worship consistently, they would just begin to know each other as friends. Would they still fight? Yes. Have you met children? Would they still be frustrated and come running to us with tattletales and things that are happening? Of course. Would they like some of the people better than others? Yes. But would they then kind of have to go back, as parents and adults would guide them, to work together within the boundaries set for them by all the adults around them who are trying to show them a better way to know friendship and be in community? And so we must remind ourselves that sometimes we are going to go through these same stages. And we might even need at times a spiritual timeout. A time where we have to go sit and reflect and pray and remind. And then when we leave that time out as adults, we, like the children, will have to figure out how to reconcile and move forward in the struggles. And where does this happen? Where does this moving forward happen in a sacred and healthy and wonderful way? Tables. Where the discussion of who is the greatest has never been a part of the message, it is the table instead where learning and loving and know more about Jesus. Jesus' journey of love is what connects us to one another and the kingdom of God. Jesus, who went to the table and was not afraid or did not let his fear stand in the way of the moment forward to see the true kingdom of God. Tables. For even those who may cause problems, because sometimes those disciples did, are still invited to participate. In fact, not only are they invited, but even in today's scripture, Jesus says he eagerly desires to share in the sacred meals of our history and our future with us. Eagerly desiring the struggles that are to come. Eagerly desiring the friendships that have brought us to this point. The place, the table where something new is about to happen. This time where the history of many other sacred meals will help guide us to a new way to see God's kingdom. Something new can only be strong, as we know, and that through the work we've done, if it's built on the relationships and lessons from our biblical history. And if we recognize the difficulties as tests of faith so that we can find our way through those difficulties with love and grace and forgiveness and peace and all the spiritual gifts that are present with the Holy Spirit. It is easier in some ways to live in a black and white world of contract relationships. But we as people of faith have not chosen the easy road. We have chosen the road of covenant by choosing to follow Jesus. Covenant has no greater or lesser participants. Everyone involved is called to be a servant. Everyone involved is welcomed and invited by Jesus, and all are serving together in the most holy and sacred ways, even amongst our failures. And today, well, it's important to realize that the contract thinks about us, and that's an important step. The covenant thinks about everyone and how to serve each other. A covenant takes away the us and them mentality. A covenant reminds us that we have a sacred promise to enter into this relationship with God as a participant. And we do that at the table, the most sacred of places. My friend Tracy Parker shared this quote from Downton Abbey with me this week. Once you say grace, it becomes the Lord's table. All manner and activity thereafter becomes the struggle we have with our relationship between each other and with God. I have no idea where that quote is in Downton Abbey, and trust me, I've looked for over 40 minutes, and I just have to share with you, so if you find it, let me know. So if that's not really true, or somebody comes after me, but I still love this quote, because today, we are eagerly desiring a way to find grace in what we are doing, to seek grace and a covenant that brings a whole new aspect and promise to the Lord's table. Are you able to faithfully work to helping us eagerly desire this meal and this struggle, even when you know that there will be difficulties and struggles? You know, in the midst of all of that, there is God. There is resurrection. There is a promised land. There is hope. There is ultimately a way to find, seek, and be the kingdom Jesus has called us to serve. This is the beauty of covenant. May we enter into it with prayer, love, mindfulness,